We get to Representative John Lewis in a sec. I first want to do a quick fact check. You were talking about the defecation on the flag incident, which a very astute Twitter person, we've tracked this down, it was a 2007, March 23, 2007 incident.
Mm. Yeah.
Well, there was an application on a police car.
But that was Canada.
Let's be clear. Well, and also in these,
that wasn't
the best detail. The best detail in the March 2007 thing is that the scene of the defecation was not just on a flag, but on a burning flag, which makes one wonder maybe he was trying to put it out. Yeah. Okay. Oh. We have now corrected that. and I'm not going to be able to pull off this segue with anywhere near the grace that I should.
I didn't say it was accurate. I said it'd make a good campaign.
Yes, that's true. Well played. Okay, Congressman John Lewis put his life on the line fighting segregation in the Jim Crow South in the early 1960s. Chairman of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, better known as SNCC. Congressman Lewis is a national leader of the Civil Rights Movement, a close colleague of Martin Luther King Jr., and organizer of the March on Washington in 1963. All of this while he was still in his early 1920s. As a speaker, Nancy Pelosi called Congressman Lewis the conscience of the Congress for his moral and ethical leadership. And tomorrow he speaks at the dedication of the Martin Luther King Jr. National Memorial on the National Mall in Washington, D.C. Congressman Lewis, fight for equality in America continues as the Occupy Wall Street movement takes root around the country and around the world. Congressman, good morning. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. I really appreciate it.
Good morning. I'm delighted and very grateful for you inviting me to be here this morning.
Congressman, we were doing some coverage this morning about the spread of these sort of Occupy protest movements around the world, 951 cities, and you're someone who really experienced what doing grassroots direct action is in the most intimate way possible, all the difficulties that come with it. What do you make of this as you see this kind of politics happening throughout the country and the world?
But for some time, there have been a growing movement in America and around the world, this growing sense of discontent. People are frustrated, so they're venting their feeling. They are standing up, they are speaking up and speaking out. They're using their bodies. They're using everything they have the same way we did during the 60s. They're putting their bodies on the line to dramatize to the larger society that they're not happy, they're not satisfied, and they want to see our government, and they want to see the business community humanize.
I want to talk to you a bit about the memorial that'll be dedicated tomorrow, but I want to ask you one more question on this topic while I have you here, because there was a video of you trying to speak to Occupy Pulse protesters in Atlanta, and it made the rounds. It got a lot of play on the internet, and I want to show everyone what happened and get you to weigh in afterwards. Here's the tape that we have.
We have someone here.
Thanks for bearing with me through that, Congressman. So they decided to let you speak, just not at that moment after they'd gotten through their agenda, but it was really viewed as a snub. In fact, the folks here with me are shaking their head. I want to ask you, what was your reaction to that moment, because it has gotten so much attention?
Well, I didn't feel that I was denied the right to speak. I couldn't stay around for 45 minutes or to an hour to speak. I had another engagement, and I had to be there on time. This is the essence of of democracy. We did this similar things during the early days of the civil rights movement, especially in the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. We tried to reach consensus, and people had to work their way through an effort, and I understood it very well. I was not offended, and since then they have invited me to speak anytime, but I'm here in Washington, and I don't plan to be back in Atlanta for a few days.
Congressman, they're going to dedicate this memorial. It was postponed by Hurricane Irene. And what do you think the significance of having a physical memorial to Dr. King on the mall is?
I think it's fitting and appropriate that the likeness of Martin Luther King Jr. be placed on the front door of America, on the front porch of America. Mm-hmm. Martin Luther King Jr. must be looked upon as one of the founding fathers of the new America, for he helped not just liberate a people, but he freed a nation. It's almost unbelievable. It's almost unreal to see the likeness of Martin Luther King Jr. standing between President Jefferson and President Lincoln. And I will never forget 48 years ago when I stood there with Dr. King, when he said, "I have a dream today, a dream in keeping with the American dream." And for generations to come, hundreds, thousands, and millions of people from all over the world will come and pay homage to Martin Luther King Jr. and to what he stood for. This man of peace, this man of love, this man of nonviolence, it's going to mean so much to all of us who participate tomorrow, but to people around the country and around the world who will be watching.
Congressman, I want to see if you can stick around. We have to go to a break now, but I have some folks here who want to ask you some questions. We want to discuss a little bit more about Dr. King's legacy. So if you don't mind staying put, we are going to come right back. We will have Congressman with us. We're just going to take a quick break. Congressman John Lewis is joining us by satellite from Washington, D.C., where he'll be taking part in the dedication of Martin Luther King Jr. Memorial tomorrow. Congressman, I wanted to get your thoughts on where we are right now in the sort of state of race relations in the country, and particularly progress. It seems to me you have these two things in tension. You have the first black president, obviously. You now have, on the Republican side, a black man who is leading polls for the nomination. At the same time, we have black unemployment, which is almost double that of white folks. Incarceration rates are higher. Foreclosure rates are higher. So it's a very difficult time for African Americans in this country economically, and yet at the same time, there is this sort of amazing progress that is symbolized in the personage of Barack Obama. How do you feel about that tension?
Well, in spite of all of the difficulties that we may face as a nation and as a people, you cannot deny the fact that we've made so much progress. Just think a few short years ago, when we marched on Washington, when we went on the Freedom Ride, when we participated in the sit-in, when we marched from Selma to Montgomery, many people could not register to vote simply because of the color of their skin in many of the 11 states of the old Confederacy, from Virginia to Texas. And we saw those signs that said white men, colored women, colored waiting. The signs are gone, mm-hmm. and they will not return. The only place our young people will see those signs will be in a book, in a museum, on a video. And with the election of Barack Obama and now with Herman Cain running and leading in the polls, that is progress. That is progress. That cannot be denied. But we have to say to America that the election of President Barack Obama is not the fulfillment of Dr. King's dream. It's only a down payment. We still have a great distance to go. The scars and stain of racism are still deeply embedded in American society. Too many people are still left out and left behind, and they're not just African American, but they're low-income whites, Latinos, Asian American, and Native American.
Congressman, I have Melissa Harris Perry here, professor at Tulane and contributor to MSNBC. She wanted to ask you a question.
Congressman Lewis, it's really a pleasure to have an opportunity to ask you this question. I wanted to ask about the design of the Dr. King Memorial itself. You know, given that your background is actually in SNCC and in part of the civil rights movement that was a challenge and a critique as well as a support of Dr. King, I'm wondering about the decision to have only King there. I mean, I wonder if there's a way in which by honoring King, which is right to do, we also somehow silence all of these other important voices that were part of the civil rights movement, that King himself as a leader is standing on the shoulders of men and of women and of people who were both supporters and critics. Is there anything you think at all that is lost in this kind of great man strategy of remembering the civil rights movement?
But Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. emerged as the symbol, as the leader, as the personification, the embodiment of the movement. But Martin Luther King Jr. always gave credit to what he called the ground crew, the people working on the ground, the field workers, those nameless and voiceless individuals, people who took part in the sit-ins, that went on the Freedom Ride, the people that did the nitty-gritty work, the people that were beaten and jailed, and so many that was killed. This is only a beginning of a long struggle to complete what Dr. King and others would call the revolution of 1776.
Congressman, I have John Fugelsang here. He wanted to ask you a question.
Good morning, Congressman. It's a pleasure. When I was growing up, I always believed that at the time of Dr. King's death, the civil rights struggle was but a part of what he was fighting for, of equal measure to nonviolence and organized labor. People forget that he was in Memphis when he died for a sanitation workers' strike. Do you feel that those elements of his legacy have been tragically overlooked? And when we discuss Dr. King, it always focuses on civil rights and equality for African Americans, and yet today's people completely forget about his struggle against violence and militarism and for working people.
Well, we must never forget that. Dr. King spoke out against violence. He spoke out against our involvement in wars and conflict abroad. One of the great speeches, and I think his best and most defining speech, was a speech he gave on April the 4th, 1967 at Riverside Church, mm-hmm. when he spoke out against the war in Vietnam. If he could speak to us today, he would tell us, he would tell the president to end the wars, bring our young men and our young women home, and use our resources not to build more bombs and guns and missiles, but to educate our children, take care of our seniors, protect the environment, provide health care for everybody, and put people back to work. When we marched on Washington on August 28, 1963, it was a march for jobs and freedom. And when Dr. King died in Memphis, he died for fighting for sanitation workers. He was in the process of organizing the Poor People's Campaign, coming to Washington to put on the American agenda the problem of poverty, hunger, and unemployment.
Congressman John Lewis, a representative from Georgia and a veteran of the civil rights movement, a colleague of Dr. King's from the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. Thank you so much, Congressman. It was such a pleasure to have you. You'll be speaking tomorrow at the dedication of the Martin Luther King Jr. Memorial, which we will be giving special coverage of here on MSNBC. Thank you so much, Congressman.
Thank you.